mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Good morning, I'm Mike DeValio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, the World Health Organization sounds the alarm on skyrocketing COVID infections in the U.S. and across the globe.
An advisor to Philippine President Duterte proposes quarterly COVID booster shots as protection against the Omicron variant.
The Philippine Election Commission records minor glitches during Wednesday's mock polls. We speak with COMELEC spokesperson James Jimenez and attorney Helen Graido of election watchdog Lente later on the program.
And a Makati court adjunts one of the Duterte government's drug cases against alleged drug lord Kerwin Espinosa.
Thanks for joining us. Twin threats. That's how the World Health Organization describes the Delta and Omicron variants as COVID cases in the U.S. and across the globe hit record highs in the past 7 days. More in this report.
The number of COVID-19 infections hit a record high over the past 7 day period in the United States and globally, according to Reuters data, which showed the average number of daily cases in the U.S. surged to more than 258,000, over 8,000 more than the previous record set last January. Officials say much of the spike is due to the highly transmissible Omicron variant racing out of control. During an audio-only press briefing Wednesday, CDC Director Rochelle Walensky said the surge is not over yet.
In a few short weeks, Omicron has rapidly increased across the country and we expect will continue to circulate in the coming weeks. While our cases have substantially increased from last week, hospitalizations and deaths remain comparatively low right now.
Top U.S. infectious disease expert Dr. Anthony Fauci said studies point to Omicron being less severe than the Delta variant among vaccinated people, but warned
we should not become complacent since our hospital system could still be stressed in certain areas of the country.
More than 76,000 people are hospitalized with COVID-19 nationwide, up 19% in the last 10 days, according to a Reuters tally. WHO Director Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus sounded the alarm for global cases Wednesday.
Delta and Omicron are twin threats that are driving up cases to record numbers, which again is leading to spikes in hospitalizations and deaths. I'm highly concerned that Omicron, being more transmissible, circulating at the same time as Delta, is leading to a tsunami of cases.
Britain, Italy, Spain, Portugal, Greece, Cyprus, and Malta all registered record numbers of new cases on Tuesday.
Nous faisons face
The French health minister told lawmakers on Wednesday that France was seeing a dizzying rise in cases, with 208,000 reported in the space of 24 hours. That's a national and European record.
The Philippines logged nearly 900 new COVID infections Wednesday, the highest in over a month. The country's positivity rate has also risen to 6.7%, the highest since October 31st. Based on World Health Organization standards, that rate should be below 5% for the pandemic to be considered under control. The health department attributes the increase in cases to higher mobility during the holiday season. But experts say it's also possible the uptick is being driven by the highly infectious Omicron variant.
Sabi natin, andyan yung possibility na Omicron. It looks possible na kung ganito kabilis yung pagdami ng kaso, it looks possible na baka nakapasok ng Omicron sa borders natin. Mm-hmm.
The Philippines has so far confirmed 4 Omicron variants, all of whom were international travelers screened at the border.
The Philippine government worried over the increasing number of COVID-19 cases in the country. Malacanang calls on Filipinos not to be complacent, saying the fight against the pandemic is not yet over. Acting presidential spokesperson Carlo Nograles also reminds local government units to be quick in responding to coronavirus outbreaks.
Of course, nababahala kami. Nababahala ang IATF, nababahala si Pangulo, nababahala ang buong puwersa ng Malacanang. At dapat ang taong bayan din po. Kaya ang panawagan, LGUs, please enforce. Pag may tumataas ang bilang ng kaso, granular lockdown. Hindi po nawala sa equation ang granular lockdown.
According to Nograles, the alert level may be raised if infections rise further.
Vice President Leni Robredo again under quarantine after one of her close in security tested positive for COVID-19. The 2022 presidential candidate said she learned about her aide's condition on Tuesday. Robredo and her team have been going around areas affected by Typhoon Odette for relief operations. A few days back, her daughter Trisha also tested positive for COVID after traveling from the U.S. She has since gotten a negative result and is on her way to recovery.
Philippine authorities validating reports an individual was allowed to leave a hotel before finishing the prescribed quarantine period. The hotel has been served a notice to explain, requiring it to submit its response to the allegations within 3 days. The tourism department reminds accredited quarantine hotels, failure to comply with health and safety protocols could lead to criminal and administrative penalties, including imprisonment.
The Philippines' stockpile of COVID-19 vaccines grows. On Wednesday, over 4 million privately procured doses of Moderna and AstraZeneca jabs arrived in the country. The Philippine government says the deliveries will be a big help in achieving its vaccination targets.
Malaki ang maitutulong niya in order for us to attain our target of vaccinating 54 million in order to attain population protection. Yung stockpile po natin, sapat na po siya sa mga pangangailangan natin sa ngayon. So early next year, we're targeting to vaccinate around 77 million before the elections.
Based on data compiled by the ABS-CBN Investigative and Research Group, over 48.6 million Filipinos have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19.
An advisor to President Rodrigo Duterte says booster shots may be needed every 3 months to keep COVID-19 infections at bay. The idea proposed by Presidential Advisor on Entrepreneurship, Joey Concepcion. He considers booster shots as the key to maintaining the country's economic recovery.
the private sector will now come back again because of the booster shots in the coming months. No, hopefully by March, we should have completed all these booster shots. No, so ang mangyari dito, palagay ko, every 3 months, mag-booster shot tayo. So that will be about 3 to 4 vaccines to be given annually. No, so in the private sector, we're already preparing for the next order of AstraZeneca in the second sem of 2022.
Israel is already testing a fourth COVID-19 vaccine dose on its medical workers.
Election-related disinformation dominated fake news content on Facebook in the Philippines this year. That's according to online news organization Verifiles, which serves as a fact-checking partner of Facebook. Its report also showed 2022 presidential candidate Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. benefited the most from these misleading posts. The head of the online verification team of Verifiles says, these posts aren't just circulating on Facebook, but on other social media sites as well.
Out of the 336 fact checks, about 120 were related to the upcoming elections. And 52 of this was overwhelmingly related to Bongbong Marcos, and it either promoted him or tried to distort facts or make totally false claims about his family's ill-gotten wealth cases or the atrocities committed under the administration of his father, the late Victor Ferdinand Sr.
Sige, sige, sure.
Poor internet connection and bad weather. Those are just some of the minor glitches the Commission on Elections experienced during its conduct of mock polls in dozens of voting centers across the Philippines. For more of what transpired during the dry run, we are joined by COMELEC spokesperson James Jimenez and attorney Helen Grido. She's a policy consultant for the Legal Network for Truthful Elections, or LENTE. Director Jimenez and attorney Grido, welcome to the program. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.
Hi, good morning.
Okay, Director Jimenez is joining us on the line. Director Jimenez, let me begin with you.
Yeah.
How did your mock elections yesterday go, and what were some of the issues encountered?
Well, the mock elections went very well. We had a very high turnout, but we did experience some difficulty when it came to some ballots in some places, especially in places where there had been heavy rainfall and some weather conditions basically affected the thickness of the ballots. So according to our published contingency measures, what we did was we had to trim a little bit of the ballot, and after that, everything worked properly. Now, apart from that, we had problems with electronic transmission because some places really had a very difficult time connecting to the transmission system. But when we switched the SIM cards around that we were using, again, that situation was resolved. The only thing that wasn't resolved actually was when a voter actually wrote something on the timing marks of the ballot, leading to the ballot being rejected. So these are the things that we saw.
Director Jimenez, explain to us a bit about the thickness of the ballot that you were talking about. Was it the width of the ballot itself? How was it affected by the weather?
Well, paper expands when there's moisture in the air, and then there's a certain amount of humidity, and that's what we saw happen to the paper. The paper sort of expanded, got a little wider than it normally is, and so we were able to trim it off and thus allow the machine to accept the ballots.
Mm-hmm. And I note that some of the issues were logistical, like the lack of, as you mentioned, the size of a thermal paper. There was also the issue that there was a lack of thermal paper, which you could hopefully address. But others are more infrastructural, like slow internet connection. How do you intend to address these issues, Director?
Well, what we do is we have multiple SIM cards available for each machine. And we also have BGADS, that's Broadband Global Area Network, and VSATs, or very small aperture terminals. Meaning to say, we have alternatives to the transmission, right? I'm sorry, we have alternative modes of transmission. So what happens is if one mode doesn't work, we switch to another. And that's exactly what happened yesterday. In some places, a SIM card failed to work, so we switched to another one.
Mm-hmm. Attorney Grido, on the part of the Legal Network for Truthful Elections, or LENTE, what were your observations during the mock elections?
Good morning, everyone. So, actually, when we observed, we tried to divide the matters that we would need to look at. So, first, we looked at the safety protocols that were implemented and how effective they were, and also then on second, are the electoral process themselves. On the part of the safety protocols, well, we observed that generally, what were stated in the general instructions of the COM, like, for example, the appointment of the DESO as medical support staff, the implementation of the isolation polling place, it was done. But there were few venues that doesn't have enough staffing, particularly for the IPP and the triage. So that is really a point for improvement. And then the part of the electoral process itself. So we've seen that some of the venues actually still implemented the three-room setup. So there's the holding area, the voting area, and the VCM room wherein they would feed the ballots. We've always noted that it could be a very dangerous or a risky setup because voters will be coming in out of rooms with their ballots on hand. So if it is exposed, it could be a good opportunity for vote buying or for near sacrificing ballot secrecy also.
Mm-hmm. That three-room setup, is that what NAMFER was referring to yesterday when it flagged this particular setup, saying it could lead to vote buying? So your explanation that when a certain voter goes out of a room to transfer to another room, there could be opportunities to actually look into the ballot and potentially sell that vote. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, correct. Because I actually personally saw it. Like, there are voters coming from the voting room with the ballots on hand, but inside the secrecy folder. But sometimes they actually go back to the vote from the VCM to the voting room because they forgot to mark, for example, the party list candidates. So they go back and forth, and no one's managing or monitoring that. And then again, we could imagine on election day that corridor would be full of voters, and we don't know their intentions or their how they would want to abuse that. But we don't want that opportunity be present during election day.
I will allow Director Jimenez to address this point first before I move on to other questions. Director Jimenez, what do you make of these observations?
Well, I think these are very valid observations. Anytime anyone goes out of the classroom with a ballot, of course, creates an opportunity for that ballot to be looked at by someone else. But I think it's telling what attorney said at the very end, where she said that they expect that the corridor would be full of people. Well, that's precisely the thing. We expect that the corridor will not be full of people, precisely because we will be controlling access to the polling place. It was not simulated, of course, yesterday, since it was a mock election, and we had to make room for observers to look at the process. But on election day itself, when loitering will be strictly prohibited, that might be mitigated, right? But having said that, we totally understand where the apprehension is coming from. And we would gladly revisit the design of these polling centers, taking these views into consideration.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me go back to Attorney Grido. Attorney Grido, are there any other observations that are a cause of concern for you? Because one of the issues that was raised yesterday, the inability to write protect the SD card in one precinct. How significant is this in ensuring the integrity of the votes cast?
Okay, the SD card is actually will be used to operate the VCM. So it's part of the basic electoral process. So if it's not right protected, it could malfunction, and that could result to delays, and that could result to delays in the process, which could lead to crowding, which could lead to aggression on the voters, because we remember from the previous elections when there were malfunctioning VCMs, it's either the voters would just opt to go home because they can't wait for another hour or another 2 hours, or if they would want to wait, then we could expect a buildup. And that's something that we don't want to happen for 2022, because here we will be operating it within the pandemic. And like what Director James said, crowd management is really a huge and a very significant problem that would need to be addressed come election day.
Director Jimenez, is the right protect issue in SD cards a big concern for the COMELEC? A potential concern here is whether the vote count could be altered later on with respect to that particular SD card.
Well, the SD card is a redundant measure. There are two of those. So it's very important to first look at the problem, really. You know, what happened yesterday, and then trace the root causes, etc. So we will be doing that. But in general, of course, you're correct. If anything happens to the SD cards, that might potentially compromise the integrity of the results from that particular machine. So that really bears looking into.
And Director Jimenez, there's one other issue flagged by our COMELEC correspondent, Ina Reformina. She was saying that in yesterday's count in P. Zamora Pasay, 390 was the actual voter turnout, but the canvassing center flashed 786 as the number of received votes after all the results were transmitted from the said voting center. Now, 786 is the total number of voters for the clustered precinct involved. So there was a discrepancy, it seems. Have you been able to look into this?
They're checking the root causes of that right now. That was one of the things that really did happen during the canvassing at the Caneta Astrodome. And we're very thankful that was noticed, no? Because that's something that needs to be addressed.
Attorney Grido, were you able to look into this issue? I note that some of your observers were at that particular polling precinct yesterday.
Oh, actually, we were there until the closing of the polls. But we've noted that the attendance in that attendance in the venue actually ticked off the latter part of the mock elections. And we actually noted that, I can actually say that, yes, the figure that was stated in the VCM, we were there, was actually 390. So, but we weren't able to check already after it was transmitted to the canvassing center.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you have a different observation. You actually saw 390.
Yes.
All right.
We actually took pictures of the screen of the VCM when it was closed, the windows. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now, how about the observance of COVID protocols in polling precincts? In your observation, have physical distancing and other protocols been observed? And how did this factor in the total voting time?
Well, generally, for example, for social distancing, it helped that the physical setup was ready to implement that. So we've seen in the different venues that the chairs were properly aligned, it's properly spaced out, and actually the electoral board members are very strict in implementing that they would really want to manage the queue early on, just from the holding area up to the voting rooms. And then we've also seen that barriers to protect the electoral boards were also set up. So that's really a good step, because that was recommended also by the health experts. What we've also noted, that people, voters and the officers themselves are actually more disciplined when it comes to masking. Because when we were monitoring in Palawan plebiscite, we've seen very inconsistent implementation of face shields, even with the officers. But now, after almost a year, even officers from COMELEC and the voters and other participants are very disciplined right now. But there's also a confusion still as to the use of the face shields, because some of the voters came in with face shields. Some actually, they have it on, but they're not using it properly. So I think the commission would need to clarify that, because according to the resolution, it's still required. But I'm sure voters are very much confused, because the national government are saying that it's not required anymore, at least for non-indoor settings. So we would need to clarify that, because that could be a barrier, because it's still an expense for the voters. So and we don't want to disenfranchise voters just because they need to spend more just to vote. Mm-hmm.
and Attorney Grindo, we're just talking about a smaller number of voters during the mock vote. So we're not talking about the actual population that will vote during election day.
Yeah, true. Really, crowd management would be really a challenge for the commission. Just at the start, from the entrance, there should be priority lanes, and because for yesterday, that's probably just 5% of the expected crowd that we would need to control and we would need to manage. Actually, that's why the move from COMELEC to appoint more support staff, so they'll be the ones who can help the queuing lines, help manage everyone that's outside or moving within the voting center. So.
Mm-hmm. Director Jimenez, from the mock poll yesterday, was there a significant increase in voting time, and how will this impact voting hours?
No, in fact, what we saw was that there was an average of around 5 minutes for each voter to actually complete the process. Of course, this will have to be adjusted up or down on election day, because on election day you'll be looking at real names on the ballot. I guess it makes a difference when you're aware that the names that you're ticking off are really inconsequential. So people were able to vote much faster, I suppose. But overall, I think that the number of voters will not be that large of an issue, as people will be flowing in and out of the voting areas fairly regularly.
Mm-hmm. Now, Attorney Grindo, given the results of the mock polls yesterday, is one day enough for the elections in May?
Well, if we're just talking about safety, of course, it would be more ideal to spread out the attendance in for more time, like more days. But we have legalities that we need to observe, like right now in the Constitution. Elections can only be done within the 24 hours or just one day. But so I guess given those limits, we would need to devise ways to manage crowds. Because, for example, we know traditionally that voters would want to come in very early in the morning. Just there's that mindset that you have to finish early, so you won't be cut off. But I guess in terms of communication, we can actually tell voters that you have from 6 a.m. to 7 p.m. on May 9, so you can just schedule it on low or off peak hours, just so the crowd will be lessened in the morning or in the towards the late hours or the last few hours of the voting day.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Director Jimenez, do you have contingency measures in case the COVID situation worsens? Because we've had situations in the past where public gatherings were limited to a certain percent of a venue's capacity. So what will happen then?
Well, we do have contingency measures, and the COMELEC, of course, has the authority to continue with the elections or to suspend it in case that is very necessary. But otherwise, we expect that the elections will continue regardless of COVID. We have been preparing for elections under COVID conditions, and then that's what we're going to do. We're going to have the elections even if under COVID conditions, and we are doing everything we can to protect against the negative effects of that.
Mm-hmm. And what's the update on COMELEC's efforts to secure additional VCMs to bring down the VCM voter ratio?
Well, our mock elections yesterday was premised on 800 voters maximum per precinct. So I would say that the procurement is going well. We have not changed our projection of 800 voters. I don't have the exact update on the procurement, but what I know is that it is proceeding well and that we are still expecting to have 800 voters per precinct.
No plans of making it 600, Director Jimenez?
No plans of making it 600. As you pointed out, even at 800, there are already concerns about timing. So 800, mm-hmm. we feel, is manageable. And that would be the ideal number at this time.
All right. Now, Attorney Grindo, what are your initial recommendations based on the mock poll?
Okay, based on the mock polls, I think first priority should be the deployment of additional personnel. that could help out in managing the queuing, managing the crowd. Because, for example, right now in the resolution of the Commission on Elections, there is already a table of computation how many additional support staff should be deployed depending on the number of clustered precincts. So that should be fully implemented. So to make sure that there is enough hands to to do the extra processes and to do to participate in implementing the safety protocols. So that's number one. Then number two, I guess we also have to fully implement the appointment of medical personnel, because that's also already stated in the resolution. So there are still venues during the mock elections that wouldn't have the presence of a medical personnel, but we know that would be very essential come May 2022, given the threats of new variants and of a surge. And also to fully implement the use and the setup of the isolation polling place, because that would work to prevent disenfranchisement, I guess, from voters who would experience symptoms. So they won't be discouraged to actually vote on by May 2020, even if they would feel symptoms, because there is a room for them. There is an allotted space for them, so that their fear of infecting others would be assuaged. So we hope that actually the steps that are already stated in the resolution would be fully implemented. We know that it was just a mock elections, but I guess we have to do it well in practice so we can do it in the actual day. So, yeah.
Lastly, Director Jimenez, is the mock poll yesterday already enough? Are you considering additional mock polls? And what aspects of yesterday's mock poll will need to be addressed by the Comelec?
Well, we'll have to evaluate the outcome of the mock elections yesterday. We'll have to take into consideration all of the other observations coming from our different partners. We also had the PNP there, by the way, so they had something to say about the security arrangements as well. We also had power providers present in some of the venues conducting their own simulations in case power went out on election day. So we have to take all of these observations into consideration, and we'll base our planning on that. As for the mock elections themselves yesterday, we pointed out a lot of the things that we need to pay attention to. And then we agree, crowd management really is very high on that list.
And one final question, Director Jimenez, before I forget this aspect. Several areas struck by Typhoon Odette have their structures actually ravaged by the storm. Is there any indication that by May, these structures will be up and running in time for the elections?
Well, as far as the Comelec is concerned, it's not about rebuilding these structures. It's about finding other structures that we can use in case the Comelec the election preparations are in fact affected by the damage wrought by the typhoon. Not to it's important for us to be focused on provisioning these alternate sites, I think, at this time.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Comelec spokesperson Director James Jimenez,
right,
and Lentes attorney Helen Grider. Moving on to more news, the Philippine Budget Department releases an additional 4.8 billion pesos in financial assistance to Typhoon Odette victims. That means an assistance of 1,000 pesos per individual for a maximum of 5,000 pesos per household. Nearly 5 billion peso aid for six typhoon regions were sent to local government units beginning Wednesday. In Surigao del Norte, Governor Francisco Matuga said residents who lost their homes can also expect an additional 5,000 peso from the National Housing Authority, which approved 80 million pesos in funds for the province.
Temporarily, what we are doing is we will be providing construction materials, tarpaulin, corrugated zinc, plywood, and ganon. So we are asking donations from private companies and individuals to help us establish this construction materials. kasi yung kailangan ngayon eh. Lalo na ngayon in Surigao del Norte, it's a rainy season.
The National Grid Corporation of the Philippines says it has fully restored power transmission lines in Mindanao 2 weeks after the onslaught of Typhoon Odette. But NGCP says there's still a lot of work to do in the Visayas region, particularly in Negros Oriental, Southern Leyte, and Bohol. That's where most of the damaged transmission poles are.
Marami pa talagang trabahong kailangan gawin kasi yun nga, napakalakas ng storm. Kung NGCP na backbone kami, 800 ang nakuha naming, ang napinsala sa aming mga poste. Lalo na po siguro yung mga kooperatiba na ang mga linya nila mas maliit kesa sa amin. Hopefully po, no, by the end of the year, at the very least, yung mga natitirang lugar, mabigyan natin ng transmission services, and NGCP will do everything it can to meet those targets ng December 31.
In other news, the Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines says its member hospitals are prepared for a possible spike in COVID cases due to the Omicron variant. The group's president, Dr. Jose Rene de Grano, says they've already observed a slight increase in new infections.
Handa po naman sila lagi, ano po. Kahit po halimbawa temporary sinara muna nila yung mga COVID beds. Pumunta po sila sa mga non-COVID areas. Nakahanda naman po sila na kung sakaling dumami ulit ang ating mga pasyente ng COVID. Ang nakakatakot lang po niyan ay pag talagang nagkaroon ng surge to the point na sosobra po sa mga bed allocation natin.
Tegrano notes hospitals are also on red alert to address firecracker-related injuries during the New Year's celebration.
And let's now get a sense of the COVID situation in public hospitals. Joining us on the line is Dr. Jonas Del Rosario, the spokesperson of the Philippine General Hospital. Good morning, Dr. Jonas. Thank you for taking our quick call.
Ay, magandang umaga sa inyo. I'm at the airport now.
Okay, thank you po. So can you give us a quick update on the COVID situation in PGH? Are you also seeing an uptick in COVID patients just like the other hospitals?
Medyo looking at our numbers, the lowest number that we had was on December 25. It was about 30 confirmed COVID patients. And then as of last night, we have 65 patients. So over the course of 5 days, we saw a slight increase in the number of patients coming to the ER for consultation. Some of them have COVID, and so some of them have to be admitted. Some have to be sent home because they have mild symptoms. So I guess it's fair to say there's a slight increase in the number of admissions now. So we're seeing as an increasing trend.
Mm-hmm. And the NCR's positivity rate has just returned to 5%, po, no? About that number. So what do you think are the reasons behind this?
I think the reasons why we're seeing a slight increase in the number of admissions, probably twofold. One is we're probably seeing the effects of increased mobility that has happened since the start of the holidays. In 2 week incubation period is probably realized now, starting December, when people started having parties, meeting their families, increased travel. That's expected. So now we're seeing a surge. It's hard to say that it's due to the Omicron variant because so far naman, we have not identified any local transmission. The ones that have been identified are all travelers from other countries.
And Dr. Jonas' concern is growing among medical workers over the rising number of domestic COVID-19 cases yet again. But what's your opinion on whether a COVID surge is imminent, all things considered?
We're hoping the surge won't happen. I think it's partly dependent on how we will react to it. It's good that we are aware that there's a slight increase, and now we have ways of trying to counter this possible surge. Measures have to be tightened, people have to be aware of it. I think everybody's afraid of having another surge, so we will be more careful this time.
And the threat of the Omicron variant as well. What do you think are the chances this would significantly increase our number of COVID cases, considering our continuous vaccination efforts, our booster shots? Do you think it would really pose a threat?
I'm sorry, again? Tell me, what did you ask?
Dr. Jonas, do you think that the Omicron variant will one day pose a threat to the Philippines, considering our continuous vaccination efforts as well as our booster vaccination efforts?
Well, just like what they are seeing abroad, even there is a number of vaccination in countries, the Omicron is causing surges in different countries. But I think it's still important that we should get ourselves immunized so that if ever the Omicron comes in, we will be having mild infections. Even though there are breakthrough infections, they should be mild, and that will help our hospitals, no, not getting overwhelmed. Mm-hmm.
And speaking of immunization, what do you think about fourth shots, like fourth booster shots?
Well, you know, we haven't really even given boosters to a lot of people. The third shot has not even been given to so many. And even there are still a lot of places which have not given the full complement of the primary series. So I think right now, you know, we're going to wait for the science to see if periodic boosters will really be the way to go. But at this time, I think it's just imperative for those who can have it already to get their booster shot.
And what do you expect in the coming days, or perhaps after the holiday season? How much of an increase do you think we'll be seeing in the number of cases, positivity rate, even hospital utilization rates?
Hello, Dr. Jonas. Yes, what did you ask?
All right. Hi. So what do you expect in the coming days after the holiday season in terms of number of COVID cases, positivity rate, hospital utilization rates?
I think there will be a steady increase in the number of patients, but I cannot really predict how much and if it's going to be the same as the surge that we experienced because of the Delta. Although theoretically, they say the Omicron variant, if ever Omicron comes into our country, it's more transmissible. So theoretically, you should expect probably an increased number of cases in the community, that eventually that will fill up our hospitals again.
Mm-hmm. So, Dr. Jonas, just to be clear, you don't think that it's the Omicron variant that's driving the slight uptick in our cases? Dr. Jonas?
Hello.
Yes. I'd repeat the question. Do you think it's the Omicron variant that's driving the uptick, the slight uptick in our cases?
Right. Well, I it's so hard to say right now. So far, it has not been proven by genome sequencing. It's too early to say. But I think, having said that, we just have to probably assume that Omicron is already here in the Philippines, so we really have to be very careful. But we have yet to hear from the Philippine Genome Center if indeed we actually have already a proof of community transmission because of the Omicron.
Okay. And lastly, Dr. Jonas, before I let you go, what should the public ultimately always bear in mind about COVID-19? Dr. Jonas.
Hello. Sorry. What about the
All right. What should the public ultimately bear in mind about COVID-19?
I think just like what was mentioned recently by the government, we have to discipline ourselves and do our own quarantine protocols to be very strict. COVID is still here, and there's a new variant that is threatening us, so we really have to be very careful. It's the holidays. People, we probably cannot help but attend gatherings, but we really have to wear masks, avoid crowded places. And, you know, the thing that we did and try to get their shots, protect yourselves from severe disease, just in case you get a breakthrough infection because of the Omicron variant.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Jonas, one last question before we let you go. Another topic, no? Is the PGH also ready for firecracker-related injuries, you know, with the New Year celebrations up ahead?
Yes, we're always ready for that eventuality. Because although for the past few years, we're seeing less and less firecracker-related injuries, which is good. But being a referral center, we're always ready for that eventuality.
All right. That's good to know. Thank you so much for taking our quick call, Dr. Jonas Del Rosario. You stay safe. Right. Have a safe flight.
Happy New Year. Thank you.
Happy New Year.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, a Makati court jumps one of the Duterte government's drug cases against alleged drug lord Kerwin Espinosa.
And the Philippine government's debt inched slightly lower in November. These and more when the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web. Iguana's banner story online, COVID cases reached record highs in many parts of the world. But the Star Stop story, environmental groups call on government to build climate-resilient homes instead of relocating those in coastal areas. And topping JMA News' website, the Okta Research Group expects the country to see even more fresh COVID cases today.
And business, least vaccinated states in the U.S. led in-store shopping sales this holiday season. Based on data from MasterCard, Arkansas, Kentucky, and West Virginia were among the states with the highest sales growth between the November 1st and December 24th. Those states are less than 55% fully vaccinated against COVID-19. In Idaho, the least vaccinated U.S. state, brick-and-mortar sales rose between 6.8% and 8%. On the other hand, in-store sales saw moderate growth in parts of the East Coast, where vaccination rates are among the highest in the U.S.
The Philippine government's debt inched slightly lower in November to 11.93 trillion pesos. That's a 0.3% decrease from October's 11.97 trillion pesos, as government paid some domestic liabilities. Favorable foreign exchange rates also pushed down the value of government borrowings. Since the start of 2021, the Philippines has added nearly 2.14 trillion pesos to its debt as it borrows heavily to finance its pandemic response and government's infrastructure program. But economic managers have said the country's debt-to-GDP ratio remains sustainable despite the uptick in borrowing.
The Philippine Environment Department allays concerns as the country lifts its ban on open pit mining. The DENR says companies will be required to rehabilitate areas that have already been mined. The agency has also issued a blanket warning that will shut down companies that will not comply with its rules.
Pag nahuli natin sila na they are not complying strictly with our policy, environmental laws, and sa mga bago nating policy sa mining, so talagang hindi tayo mangingimi na pasarado natin yan. Yan ang in-emphasize ng ating kalihim dyan.
The late DENR Chief Gina Lopez enforced the ban on open pit mining in 2017, citing its potential for a disaster. But the COVID-19 pandemic shattering the Philippine economy and mines and geosciences bureau says open pit mining could boost state revenues.
A look now at the financial markets. The Dow and S&P 500 reached new record highs Wednesday as investors shrugged off concerns about the fast spreading Omicron variant. This extends the Dow's winning streak to 6 days, boosted by a jump in shares of U.S. retailers. The tech-heavy Nasdaq, meanwhile, bucked the trend, shedding 0.1%. Over in Europe, markets were mostly lower as fears about the Omicron variant continued to dent sentiment. But London's FTSE advanced as it placed catch-up following the holiday break. And over here in Asia, stocks were mixed, with the Omicron variant also on top of mind of investors. The PSE index rose for a third straight day, climbing back above the 7,300 level as it looks to end the year on a high note.
A Philippine court junks one of the Duterte government's drug cases against alleged drug lord Kerwin Espinosa. The Makati court says prosecutors failed to present sufficient evidence to prove conspiracy to commit drug trafficking. It adds a statement from the government's sole witness, Marcelo Adorco, was inadmissible because it was taken without the presence of a lawyer. But Justice Secretary Menardo Guevara says Espinosa is not yet off the hook as he has other drug cases in Manila and Leyte.
Hong Kong police arrest 6 people in a raid on the office of the pro-democracy news website Stand News. The senior editorial staff are among those detained for alleged conspiracy to publish seditious content. This is the second major raid on a media outlet in Hong Kong this year. Last June, authorities raided the premises of pro-democracy newspaper Apple Daily, arresting its executives for alleged collusion with a foreign country. The newspaper was subsequently shut down.
Over in India, the government stirs controversy after cutting off funding for the charity founded by Mother Teresa. Details in this report.
The Indian government has blocked Mother Teresa's charity from receiving funds from abroad. The move comes amid rising intolerance towards religious minorities in the country. Founded in 1950, Mother Teresa's Missionaries of Charity supports thousands of nuns around the world who run hospices, schools, leper colonies, and homes for abandoned children. On Saturday, Prime Minister Narendra Modi's government refused to renew the charity's license under the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. The Home Ministry said in a statement that while considering the application, it had noticed some, quote, adverse inputs. The charity has also been accused by hardline Hindu groups of leading religious conversion programs. The MOC has rejected those allegations, and local residents of Kolkata said on Tuesday they had seen no evidence of it.
I would request all our government officials in the central government to please come outside Mother House every morning at 6 o'clock and see the line of homeless poor people stretching for more than 1 mile who are given a free meal. Not one of those people is a Christian and not one of those people are asked to become Christians.
Since Modi came to power in 2014, right-wing Hindu groups have consolidated their position across states. They have launched attacks on minority groups, claiming they are trying to prevent religious conversions. Now, several states have passed or are considering anti-conversion laws that challenge the right to freedom of belief in the country.
The president of the Philippine Athletics Track and Field Association president, or PATAFA, vows to fight the Philippine Olympic Committee after its executive board decided to declare him persona non grata. The POC has decided not to recognize Philip Rico as PATAFA's head amid his dispute with Filipino Olympic pole vaulter EJ Obiena. The POC described Rico's actions as a form of harassment, but Rico insists the POC shouldn't involve itself in the issue.
Is not within their jurisdiction. This is an intra-NSA issue, and under their own constitution, the Philippine Olympic Committee's Constitution, such intra NSA issues are to be resolved first within the NSA. It's an issue between the management and the board, in this case, because it was the board that asked for his asked that he be investigated, and him. So it's not me against him, it's the PATAFA itself. And the issues raised against him, the investigation that was conducted, was okay. Because of certain money matters. Wala yung harassment mo.
Pico accused Obiena of supposed irregularities in paying his coach, which the coach himself denied.
Let's now find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing today with our correspondent, Romel Conclara.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here's the latest stories making the headline amongst the Filipino community. We begin with hundreds of people waiting in long lines in New York City's Times Square, not to see the latest must-see show. Rather, they were waiting to be tested for COVID-19 as the U.S. braces for an expected uptick in Omicron infections. Omicron was first detected in November and now accounts for nearly three-quarters of U.S. cases and as many as 90% in some areas, such as the Eastern Seaboard. The average number of new U.S. coronavirus cases has risen 45% to 179,000 per day over the past week, according to a Reuters tally.
We're seeing hospitalizations rise. It means our hospitals in some places are going to get overrun, but in terms of equipment, both in terms of equipment and staff. That's why we stockpiled and pre-positioned millions of gowns, gloves, masks, and ventilators. We're mobilizing an additional 1,000 military doctors and nurses and medics to help staff hospitals. FEMA is deploying hundreds of ambulances and EMS crews to transport patients.
In sports, film NBA star Jordan Clarkson has become the latest player to get into a near altercation with a courtside heckler during Utah's win against the Spurs on Monday, at least until his teammates intervened. A Twitter thread by San Antonio journalist Raul Dominguez Jr. shows a fan getting escorted out after his confrontation with Clarkson.
The guy just keeps antagonizing me and then, like, almost challenges me, like, what you gonna do after, you know, saying a bunch of stuff. But, you know, man, I make money. I ain't trying to lose no money. I'm gonna lose more money than he gonna lose. He's probably just gonna get kicked out of the game. But, you know, we playing basketball, having a good time. Fans gotta learn, you know, we human, we people too. You know, stuff like that just can't fly, especially on the NBA floor where, you know, guys are doing their job.
Despite the incident, Clarkson, who grew up in San Antonio, led all scorers with 23 points as the Jazz beat the Spurs 110-104. And finally, performing in English is nothing new for many original Filipino music or OPM singers. But it's not quite as easy for American recording artists singing in Tagalog. Lauren Allred, the powerful voice behind Never Enough from The Greatest Showman, sang the Tagalog song Araw Gabi in musical director producer Troy Loretta's Gilio album.
Of course, I was intimidated. You know, Tagalog is a very complex language.
Meanwhile, the R&B band All For One, with famous hits like I Swear, sang April Boy Regino's Pang-ano ang puso ko.
Troy was very, very good in the studio and making sure that we pronounced it up.
Gilio is the second volume to Loretta's OPM collective series featuring talented global artists.
And those were the latest headlines from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/tscnews and the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Now back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, Romel. Before we go, the Philippines releases new postage stamps to mark the 125th death anniversary of national hero Jose Rizal. Postmaster General Norman Fulgencio says the stamps seek to remind Filipinos of Rizal's love and compassion for the country. Rizal was sentenced by firing squad in 1896. His death sparked the Philippine Revolution that sought to overthrow Spanish colonizers. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.